Testing, 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 testing.
We'll get it.
Testing.
I really need a quick drink, and then I'll be
testing. Testing, testing, testing. Okay.
Are you going to need a back scan?
Yeah.
Oh, I got to have one of those.
You want to? Okay.
Yeah. This is too small.
Oh, I don't have time to get a drink. They're all cooked.
Good morning, everyone. What a joy it is to hear everyone just talking and laughing. It's a privilege to be able to come together and worship our God together. And so we're going to do that this morning. Please stand as we sing and as we start out here in worship this morning.
Our hope in life and death.
Oh, sing, eyes are open, life and death.
Now and ever we confess,
Christ our hope in life and death.
I want to share some verses with you this morning, and it's from John. I can get us up and going here. John 14, and interesting enough, we were at our transition team, and one of the things that Dave had mentioned is that we all need a Thomas in our life, too, and above others as well. And so this kind of sprung to me a little bit as I was kind of going back in. And John 14, 5 through, I'm just going to read a few verses here, 5 through 7. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are. We don't know where you are going. So how can we know the way?" So asking questions. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." What an amazing promise that is, and what an amazing focus that we have. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And that really is just, you know, there's a lot of stuff that's going on now, but our focus should be on Christ and Christ alone. So let's continue as we sing. There's a portion of your bulletin that has a place for prayer, praises, and requests. If you would just fill that out send it to the center. Would love to pray for those. And Roger will pick those up as we go into the third song, as we still focus on Jesus, Jesus, only Jesus.
Good morning. Ooh, this isn't that low. It is good to be worshiping the Lord Christ alone this morning. He is our strength. This morning I received a note from Gary Clone, and I wanted to remember to pray for him, so I'm going to read this note before I pray and before I go into the family of the week. but this Gary and Ann clone. To the great members of Kabekona Community Church, we thank you for the gracious gift of money that we received as Family of the Month. It is really a gift from God. We received it just when we needed it. We are so grateful for every one of you. I am getting stronger and better able to get around every day. There are good days and bad days. Hopefully we'll be able to return to be with you in church. Some days I can't get into the truck, but may God bless you and keep you all safe. P.S. It's times like this that really make one proud to be a Christian. Love you all, Gary Clone. And so keep remembering Gary and Ann in your prayers and in his continued healing and strengthening of his body. But as many of you know, or most of you know, each week we recognize different family of the week. And this week we recognize Chris and Debbie Roller. And so I'm going to have a note here to read from Debbie. Praise for our healthy families, and I thank the Lord every day for our great health and that he has given to our family. Pray for our nation for the next 4 years. It troubles us so. Pray, of course, for health and safety every day. And a couple of verses she has written down here is 1 Peter 5:7. Cast all your cares on him, for he cares for you. And she has Jeremiah 29:11 written down here. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and future. And I wanted to read just the next couple of verses after that as well and give you a little context. This is as the Israelites were going into captivity in Babylon when he said that to them. But then he continues this. Then you shall call upon me and shall go and pray to me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye search for me with all your heart. Babylon was not doing that the Israelites were not doing that very well, and which is why they went into captivity in Babylon. And as Debbie said, we don't know what all these next 4 years hold and what each day holds. We don't know what the next 100 years hold. But we need to seek the Lord with all of our heart. He's got great plans for us, doesn't he? He's got great plans for us, but we need to seek the Lord with all of our heart. Chris and Debbie, thankful for you guys and your, I guess you're probably using this camera, huh, James? Thankful for you guys and your heart and love and service in so many different ways, and just thankful for you and glad we can be praying for you guys today. Right, I didn't see Debbie. I didn't miss her, right? Nope. Okay. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. God, we come before you, seeking you this morning. Lord, as these verses say that you, if we seek you, we shall find you. If we search you for you with all of our heart. Lord, let us seek after you. Let us search after you. Let our hearts be touched by you. Let us call upon you. Let us pray unto you. And you hear us. And Lord, we know that you have good plans in store. We know of the hope of eternity, the hope of eternal life for all those that believe and trust in your name. As we sang this morning, in Christ alone. In you alone we have victory. Lord, let us seek after you. Let us not forget you, not leave you, but instead seek after you. Let our lives be focused on who you are, our awesome God, our Savior, our Redeemer, the one who forgives us from all our sins. We don't need to worry about what tomorrow holds or what these next years hold, but we can leave it in your hands, knowing that we can cast all of our cares upon you. For we know that you care for each of us. So God, thank you for who you are. I thank you for your love for us. I thank you for the trust and the hope that we can have in you, our awesome God. Lord, we do pray for our nation. We do pray for what's going on now. I do pray for President Biden, his cabinet, those that are around him. Lord, I ask that, I guess I don't always know what words to pray, And so, Lord, I just ask that you'd be present, that you would bring good counsel, thwart bad counsel. Lord, just as your body, as believers in you, Lord, let us stand for your truth. Let us stand and proclaim who you are. Let us live out who you are to friends, neighbors, and strangers. That our nation might know who you truly are. So God, we seek you today. We seek you this morning. Thank you that we're able to meet together, to encourage each other in our walk with you, to study your word together. And Lord, let your word impact our hearts and lives that we might live for you each day. Lord, I do pray for our family of the week. I pray for Chris and Debbie Roller. Lord, I thank you and I praise you with them for the health in their families and just what you're doing in their hearts and lives. Lord, I just continue to pray for them each day in the different ways that you have them serving, whether on the road or here or Debbie at May Creek or wherever you might take them. God, I ask that you be with them and their family and encourage them this day, and I thank you for them. And I praise you for them that praise you for them this morning. Continue to bind them together in you, to be in your word, and to living out what it means to have faith in you. Lord, today I pray for Gary Clone, and continued asking for strength and health for him and his body, and for Ann, continue to bind them together in you and giving them opportunities to live for you. God, I thank you for them, and I pray for them right now. I pray for Gary and his body and the strength and his heart and each of his blood veins. And Lord, you're the one who gives life, and God, we pray for him right now. We need to ask for strengthening for him. Lord, I pray for Lily's friend's wife, Luke's wife, and the stomach issues that she's been experiencing. Lord, I continue to pray for her and encourage her and help her to heal. Lord, I pray for Don Hoagland's scans that are coming up. I believe not this week, but the following week. And God, I pray for that and just continue to be with Don and Laurel and just continue binding them together in you. And as they proclaim your name and it's showing so much trust in you and the hope in you. God, I do pray for them though. Lord, you, God, are the one who knows our bodies better than any other. You created us and uniquely designed each of us. So Lord, I pray for Don. I pray for the scans coming up and the doctors and nurses. And Lord, we know that whatever was of concern, you can just remove that. So God, I just pray for him and ask your hand and your touch to be on him. But thank you for the hope and the peace that they're able to go forward with knowing you. Lord, I pray for a family in our community, for the family of Shell Lind, Clyde. Lord, as she passed away here this weekend, Lord, I pray for them all. I know she was loved by many in her family as well as in the community. And so, God, I just pray. I pray for the family. I pray for the Clyde family. And as they gather for worshiping you today, just reading about her life, even just in Rob Clyde's post on Facebook yesterday, that just the testimony and the praise and the hope that they can give of what it means to know you and to love you, and the saying, man, my sister beat us to eternity. God, I thank you for the hope that we have in you. And I pray for the family, be with them as they grieve, comfort them. But also we do praise you with them for a life that sought after you and lived out her life for you. Continue to be with the family and each family member and the changes that this brings as well. Ask that you be with them and ask your hand to be around each of them. Lord, as we continue this morning, guide our hearts to you. Let us seek after you. As we pray to you, as we sing to you, as we hear from your word, be with Pastor Dave as he speaks. Let us let your word infiltrate our hearts and draw us closer to you. In your precious name, Jesus, amen. There's victory in Jesus. We're going to sing number 353 in the hymnal, that there's victory in Jesus. And I know the Clyde family has the hurt and the pain that they're going through right now, or the loss, but they're also celebrating the victory in Christ. Let's sing together, Victory in Jesus, 353. Announcements, just as you note them in the bulletin, with the activities going on this week, a prayer meeting here tomorrow morning with the men, 6:30, and women's Bible study, in the evening, as well as men's Bible study. Women's Bible study. Connie's place was canceled this week, right? It's at Pat's house. Pat's house. And then men's Bible study here. Tuesday evening, there is WFC meeting here at the church. Do you need Melissa? Do you need to say anything about that? Nope. All right. 6:30 Tuesday evening, ladies, for WFC meeting. Wednesday night, Kids Connection, and Thursday morning, Women's Bible Study at Pam's place. Coming up here, though, coming up on the following week with our transition focus group, and many of you have gotten emails about that and responded back to Connie about whether you're able to attend that meeting, but all those that participate in the survey are being asked to come and join together for a focus group meeting on Tuesday the 9th here at 6:30. And then on the 10th, that Wednesday is a family night lasagna feast, and there is a sign-up sheet on the counter out there, and we are going to have an enjoyable meal together. And so we're going to have some pretty handy lasagna, I think. Right, Jeff? Maybe. We'll see what happens. Jeff's going to help make some lasagna for us, is my understanding. So we're looking forward to that. And to time of fellowship together, as well as spending time in the Lord. And so we're looking forward to that time together. But sign-up sheet is out there in the foyer for things to sign up for additional sides to bring along with that. But take a note at the other things that going on. I'm planning a family activity here at the church on the 13th as well. And the activity is actually to be determined, weather depending. And so, but we'll watch the weather and give more updates as that comes. But take note of those things. Let's continue in song together. It's number 344. And during this song, if the kids want to get their kids' packs, they can go grab the kids' packets in the back for anybody, as well as the offering plate is back there for after the service for those that want to give. A grace greater than our sin. Number 344, grace greater than our sin. Thank you. Pastor Dave, would you come and share this morning's message with us? And as Dave's come up here, our memory verse for the last Sunday in January. James, do you have that? Nehemiah 1:5. Let's say this together. Then I said, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of unfailing love with those who love him and obey his commands. Nehemiah 1:5. I'll collect my stuff and get out of the way here for you, Dave.
Good morning. Get all situated up here. 2 weeks from today is Valentine's Day. Just a warning to the guys. Say what? The ladies already know how to handle that day. And the guys, I'll just a heads up. That day we're going to have a sermon and message on marriage. So if you're thinking about getting married, you're thinking about getting out of your marriage, you're thinking about sustaining your marriage, I would recommend that you come for that day. We'll have some laughs, we'll have some tears, we'll see what the scripture talks about when we think about marriage. Lessons that took me 74 years to learn. Today, early lessons on cheating, lying, and death. I learn conceptually, not analytically, which means I do well with the big picture, but not too well with the details, especially if those details have anything to do with numbers. However, I am somewhat of a perfectionist, so I get easily frustrated at times. I have very little aptitude for math. It's a good thing I'm a pastor, because if I was ever asked to be the treasurer of a church, you would sink the budget fast. I remember my dad hiring a math tutor to help me survive Algebra 1. Most particularly, I remember nights in our basement. Dad made a floor-to-ceiling chalkboard on the middle of our basement wall. And Dad and Fred spent hours in that hole trying to teach this analytically challenged puppy to help him understand algebra. They were getting nowhere because I was getting nowhere. And when the final exam was being taken, I concluded I was not going to be able to pass this exam. This was a lost cause. I wasn't even sure if God would or could intervene. So I resorted to the next best thing, cheating. Raise your hand. No, I wouldn't be fair. Come on, yeah. I literally kept sneaking a look at the guy's paper across from me, and I wrote down every number that he wrote down. With 5 minutes to go in the class, I discovered that our teacher, Mr. King, had given out different tests. The kid next to me had an entirely different test than I had, and all my answers were wrong, so I started erasing my papers. My hands started sweating, my paper started tearing, and Mr. King, who by the way was my neighbor, sent me down to the school office. I was told to call my parents. The very worst part of the whole affair. I received an F for the class. My reputation was tarnished, particularly because I was the president of the high school Bible club. An interesting concept in the public school today. You probably wouldn't find that often. I learned a valuable lesson about forgiveness and restoration through this regrettable experience. That very same weekend, Mr. King, my algebra teacher, and my neighbor asked me to babysit his children. He never brought up the cheating ever again. He sensed that my heart was broken. He sensed it was more than a simple sorrow for getting caught. My spirit was wounded, and I had learned a lesson. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, most of you know this by heart, if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from every wrong. But I still had many hard lessons to learn. Like my namesake David, I would continue to learn, often the tough way, that there are ramifications for bad choices. There are ramifications for bad choices. And I would add an aside here. I think we do our children, moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas, I think we do our children a disservice if we don't allow them to suffer ramifications for poor choices. Yes, there is grace. Yes, there is forgiveness. But grace and forgiveness do not always negate circumstances. Let me illustrate. My parents held a high view of church, as do many of you. So high that when the church doors were open, we were there. We were not allowed to miss church unless we were sick or out of town. That meant morning and evening church on Sunday and Thursday evening prayer and Bible study during the week. My parents should have known that I was less than truthful when I told them I couldn't go to Sunday evening church one particular night because I had homework to do. This boy never used schoolwork to get out of anything. I would do anything but schoolwork. But in a weak moment, they agreed to let me stay home. They decided to let my sister stay home with me. We had strict instructions to stay in the house and not go outside. I watched my parents' car leave the house and drive out of sight. And then I grabbed my sister and my baseball bat and ball and headed out to play ball with my neighbors, my intention all along. It wasn't long before I was going to be next at bat. I was warming up, pretending to be a professional baseball player like my team, the Detroit Tigers. And one of those warm-up swings hit my sister in the head. Would like you to moan on for my sisters. I really nailed her. This was no talk your sister out of crying deal. You're not really hurt. Get a grip on life. Judy was really hurt, and I was in serious trouble. I had to drag her home and then call my parents at church. Have you ever been in a situation like this? Psalm 51. Got your Bibles turned to Psalm 51. It's David writing Psalm 51. David had made some poor choices, some serious choices. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion. Blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion, it haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner. Yes, from the moment my mother conceived me, but you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Do not keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart. Create in me a clean heart, oh God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence. And don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. Forgive me for shedding blood, O God who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you. You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice, and this is verse 17, it's really key. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. Look with favor on Zion and help her. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will be pleased with sacrifices offered in the right spirit, with burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will again be sacrificed on your altar. So early on, I learned lessons on cheating, lessons on lying, lessons on the ramifications for making bad choices, but at the same time, lessons about forgiveness, lessons on restoration, and a reminder that God looks at our heart. Bill McCartney from Promise Keepers told us it is doubtful that God ever uses a man effectively until he first breaks him. And he adapted that quote from A.W. Tozer, who similarly said it is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he has hurt him deeply. That's why I like Psalm 51, verse 17 that we read. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit, a broken and repentant heart. That's consistent with what Bob Pierce, founder of World Vision, said years ago. He said, let my heart be broken with the things that break the heart of God. Most certainly my sin, my disobedience, my cheating and lying broke the heart of God. But not all my early life experiences were negative. For the most part, they were incredibly positive. I mentioned last week that my grandmother, my dad's mother, died due to complications after the birth of twins. Dad went to live with his Aunt Maggie. I knew her as Grandma Maggie. When she was in her 90s, she came to live at our house, a precedent for our family. My dad and mom lived with my sister before they died, and Sherry's folks lived with us for 14 years before we moved to Haiti, and a short time after we returned from the island. Because I learned the value and the importance of family, I learned that life is more than what I can get out of it for myself. Life doesn't revolve around me. Life is giving and caring and looking out for the needs of others. Having your folks live with you will not work for everyone, I understand that. It involves sacrifice, it involves inconvenience, it's not always easy. It's like a marriage that we'll talk about in 2 weeks. You have to work at it. It just doesn't happen by itself. You must develop a want-to attitude. And I learned my first lesson about death when Grandma Maggie died in our home. My dad kept vigil at her bedside, and when she breathed her last breath, Dad came out and asked me if I'd like to kiss Grandma goodbye. Grandma Maggie had always had time for me to come into her room, to shut the door, hold me on her lap, and rock me in the rocking chair. I was going to miss those times. And let me say that there is nothing I've enjoyed more than having my grandchildren say, Grandpa, I love you. And now I have 10 of them and 2 great-grandchildren, another great-grandchild, male or female, we're not sure, but he or she is on their way in June. Most of my grandchildren are too big to jump on my lap, but we had those days, and I still love it. Even when the big ones try it, it makes me feel good. When Grandma died, I knew she was in heaven. She was with Jesus. No more bumping into cupboards and getting big black and blue marks on her arms. She now had a new body and perfect eyesight, and as I kissed her still warm body, I was formulating in my young mind and heart a theology of death and dying. I was not like those who had no hope. I knew I would see Grandma again, and I will, because Grandma had a personal relationship with Jesus, and so do I. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so that you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And first the Christians who have died, like Grandma, will rise from their graves. Then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. So the Bible says, so encourage each other with these words. And I applied those lessons and that hope years later when my dad and mom went to live and be with Jesus. Early on, I also learned a valuable lesson about prayer and healing. Our pastor's son in Bay City, Michigan, where I went to church and lived, she developed cancer, serious cancer. They didn't give her long to live. So one Sunday morning, the elders of our church had Nancy come up to the front, and they laid hands on her and they prayed for her healing. This was a fascinating experience for me. I had never seen or witnessed this before. Nancy had a request of God. She said, give me 10 more years to create a desire in my children's life for Jesus. And 10 years later, to the month, Nancy died. During those 10 years, all her children fell in love with Jesus. Does this mean that God always heals? You might be surprised at my answer. Yes. God always heals the believer. God always heals those who have committed their lives to him. It's just that sometimes that healing must wait until heaven. But God always heals his children, sometimes here on earth. James 5, 14 to 15, are any of you sick? You should call for the elders of the church to come and pray over you, anointing you with oil in the name of the Lord. And such a prayer offered on faith will heal the sick, and the Lord will make you well. I had another grandmother. Her name was Mary. Grandma Mary, my mom's mother, also lived in Bay City, Michigan. And I never knew either of my grandfathers. They both died before I was born. But I did have the privilege of knowing Grandma Mary. You might find this hard to believe, but she liked me. She thought I was a pretty wonderful kid. In fact, I used to be. There was a problem, however. Life for me revolved around church, Sunday school, vacation Bible school, and camp. But Grandma didn't want to hear anything about church. She didn't want to hear anything about the Bible studies I was learning, the Bible stories. She just plain didn't want to hear about Jesus. She was a non-attending member of the Methodist church in town. My step-grandfather was the church janitor in that church. I just remember that Grandpa liked to smoke big Cuban cigars in the church boiler room. So even though I had a wonderful relationship with Grandma Mary, I was not able to share the most important aspects of my life with her. That I wasn't able to share until she was 80 years old. Grandma Mary, as I said, developed throat cancer. She was dying and in the hospital. Our pastor often visited her, and one day, Grandma Mary gave her life to Jesus. Wow, total transformation. This woman that had no time for Jesus and no time for spiritual things suddenly had a story to tell. And tell the story she did to anyone in the hospital who would listen. She literally went up and down the halls of the hospital to see if anybody would listen to her testimony about giving her life to Jesus. It was time for me to leave for Chicago to attend college and seminary. Grandma Mary had slipped into a coma. Excuse me. The doctor said that she would die at any time. Early in the morning on the way out of town, we stopped at the hospital so I could say goodbye to Grandma. The second time I would say goodbye to a grandmother. When I walked into the room, Grandma Mary came out of her coma. She looked at me and told me that she was praying that the Holy Spirit would be with me and prepare me for the ministry. She held my hand and as she prayed. I'd never heard my grandmother talk to me like this before. When I left the room, she went back into a coma, and 1 week later, she died. It was like the burning bush episode when God had a message for Moses, when he wanted to get his attention, Exodus 3:4. When the Lord saw that he had caught Moses' attention, God called him from the bush. And I believe that God brought Grandma Mary out of that coma. God was preparing me for the ministry, and he used a miracle to get my attention and to affirm it and confirm it. He used Grandma Mary to affirm the call he had made on my life several years earlier. In summary, God is in the business of using both our successes and our failures for his glory and his purposes. Through cheating and lying, God taught me that there are ramifications for bad choices, but also forgiveness and grace when we confess and repent of our sin. It is doubtless that God ever uses a man effectively until he first breaks him. And through the death of my grandmothers, God taught me about what happens when we die. Then we don't have to grieve like those who have no hope. And through prayer, I learned that God always heals his children, sometimes even on this earth, sometimes for a specific period of time, sometimes at the end of life, all for his glory, all for his purposes. James 5:16 says, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. God gave Nancy Olson 10 more years to create a desire in her children's heart for Jesus. God didn't give up on my Grandma Mary. He brought her to himself at 80 years of age, and both Grandma Nancy and Grandma Mary for his glory and his purposes. These were all early lessons, but God hasn't finished taking me to school because of the dumb choices I still continue to make. And through the years, God has been continuing to teach me valuable lessons about prayer and healing and death. God always heals his children, sometimes even here on earth. Psalm 116:15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. The New Living Translation says, the Lord cares deeply when his loved ones die. And the message says, when they arrive at the gates of death, God welcomes those who love him. I want to wrap this up with the following plea from the Apostle Paul. 2 Corinthians 5:18-6:2. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who had never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. As God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. So don't waste your life. I guess that would be my encouragement to you. Don't waste your life. Take advantage of opportunities to learn valuable lessons from both the successes and the failures that come your way. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. A portion of Psalm 51 from the Message paraphrase. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a Genesis week from the chaos of my life. Don't throw me out with the trash or fail to breathe holiness in me. Bring me back from gray exile. Put a fresh wind in my sails. Give me a job teaching rebels your way so that the lost can find their way home. Commute my death sentence. God, my salvation, God, and I'll sing anthems to your life-giving ways. Unbutton my lips, dear God. I'll let loose with your praise. Going through the motions doesn't please you. A flawless performance is nothing to you. I learned God worship when my pride was shattered. Heart-shattered lives ready for love. Don't for a moment escape God's notice. Charles Stanley said, brokenness is God's requirement for maximum usefulness. Let me repeat. Brokenness is God's requirement for maximum usefulness. Next week, I was surprised how much my dad had learned in 4 years. Don't make the mistake of equating wisdom with knowledge. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 8 and 9 says, listen, my child, to what your father teaches you. Don't neglect your mother's teaching. What you learn from them will crown you with grace and clothe you with honor. And as I said, 2 weeks on marriage, the title of that sermon is, who was that girl in the back seat with the long brown hair? We've been married now 50 years. Praise the Lord. Father, thank you for the lessons that I have learned in life and that I am still learning. I know that every one of us here this morning are also in the process of learning lessons. Some are having victory at this point with the choices they're making. And some of us are in the middle of the ramifications of making poor choices. But you call each of us to receive forgiveness for our sins, to restore us again to the joy of our salvation. Thank you, Father, that you haven't given up on us. And what an example it was for Grandma Mary at 80 years of age of turning her back on you and walking 180 degrees away from you, and yet at 80 years of old, with a hard heart, you softened her heart, and she gave her life to Jesus and was used by you to be the encouragement and she came upon, at that time in my life, with that miracle in the hospital, she became affirmation of your call to my life and sustained me for the years ahead as I prepared to be a pastor. Encourage us, forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We come to you with broken hearts, asking that you will restore them and that you will use them for your purpose and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
going to close with number 653 in the hymnal. It's Whiter Than Snow.